Jean-François Roberge, hello. Hello. In the Quebec government, you're Minister for Relations with Canada, you're Minister for Canadian Francophonie, you're the Minister for Secularism, you're Minister for the French language as well. I, Jean-François Roberge, declare under oath that I will fulfill the duties of my office. Do you consider that you're in charge of four different ministries, or rather one large ministry which encompasses all these identity issues? It's more like one big ministry, because there's consistency, there's coherence. My wife sometimes says jokingly that I'm a minister of the nation and its institutions, because there's a link. We have a way of doing things in Quebec that allows us to preserve our areas of jurisdiction. And today we've had some very interesting discussions at the Council of Federation. Your career was in education. You were an elementary school teacher in the riding of Chambly, and then you later became a member of Parliament. What brought you to teaching? Well, I was drawn to the world of entertainment, the world of the arts. I was involved in theater, improv. I did a lot of monologues when I was in high school, that sort of thing. And at one point, I met an exceptional teacher, Mr. Léon Simard was his name.
Dans sa classe.
And he used to do all that in his class. And he was inspiring. He was striking. He was a great pedagogue. When I saw him, I thought, this is what I want to do. He was the inspiration. He was an exceptional teacher. And he showed me that I could be a teacher who's creative and adds color to their class. So that's why I did it. A way of bringing everything you love together. Yeah, I've always loved working with people. I listen to people, like understanding them, helping them. I think that that's how I came to teaching. When I started my first internship, I knew that's what I wanted to do. And from teaching, you made the leap into politics. What brought you to politics? I've always been an idealist. I was very, very, when I was very, very young, I used to read La Presse in paper form. And I would talk to my father about politics, talk to my mother, I would talk about what we should do. Why isn't the government doing this? Who is this guy? We talk politics a lot at home. So once I got to Cégep, I got involved in a student association a bit. I had a desire to change the world at university that developed further. I'm really involved in politics because of my involvement in student associations. What did your parents do for a living? Well, they started out as real estate agents, and then they became stained glass workers. Yes, they did. So they were entrepreneurs, business people. They started a business, and then they bought a building. It was one of the three biggest workshops in Montreal. So they created, repaired, they gave classes. And my first job was working for my parents when I was 16 years old. I was always teaching stained glass. I was already teaching stained glass to adults every Saturday when I was 16. And in the summer, I would repair old stained glass items, Tiffany lamps, things like that. It's a craft that stems back to the Middle Ages, but we still do it today. You were an activist for the Parti Québécois. Why did you decide to run for the CAQ? After being in the student movement and then an association called Fosse Jeunesse, still exists today, very proud of that. I was in an advocacy group for a while, and at one point I thought, I have to leave this world of advocacy and I have to get to work. And the values of the Parti Québécois were the ones I felt really resonated with me. I was very nationalistic, but I was disappointed. I felt that the Parti Québécois didn't really do much for the country. It didn't govern. It didn't make the right decisions. And I was on the inside. I was involved. I wanted to make changes in education. They didn't want to make those changes. They didn't want to displease people, displease unions. We'll need them in the referendum, except their referendum didn't happen. We didn't have a country, and the government wasn't making the right decisions. So I decided, well, enough of compromise. I've always been an idealist, so I left in the 2012 election. It was the first time that you ran. Did you run with François Legault? Yes, I I did. I'm one of the founders of the CAQ. Before it was a party, when it was a citizens' movement, a coalition for the future of Quebec, we're finally going to clean up public life and make sure that from now on, no one hustles with our money. The speaking tours François Legault did with Charles Sirois while I was there, sometimes I was the opening act. I'd make a little speech on our vision of education, and then the party was founded. And so I ran in first in 2012. I was defeated. But I kept going anyway. Since the 22 election, you've been minister responsible for the French language or minister responsible for relations with Canada. I know that Ottawa has finally adopted its new version of the Official Languages Act last June. Now, of course, the senator said that the bill isn't perfect. No bill is perfect, but I think that with Bill C-13, we've made historic progress. Now, this bill recognizes the precarious nature of French in Quebec. It recognizes that French is an endangered language in Quebec. It said that your relationship with your counterpart at the time, Ms. Jeanette Petitpas-Taylor, was very, very good. Did this good understanding contribute to your success, do you think? Well, ideally, bilateral relations between the government of Quebec and the government of Canada, well, it's a relationship based on two states. Sometimes we don't share the same interests, but we do talk to each other nevertheless. I have the greatest respect for Jeanette. I call her Jeanette. She calls me Jean-François. We get along very, very well. When I was in Ottawa, I would have dinner with her. We understood each other. We didn't exactly have the same mandate, but I think we both understood that we were capable of finding common ground. It took a few months, and we found that common ground. That's the type of thing I want to do as Minister of Relations with Canada. I want to find common ground. I want to find win-win solutions as well. My goal is not for Quebec to crush Canada. I don't want to show Ottawa. No, because anyway, it always comes back. It comes back to beat you, if you like. Well, if there's the other side refuses to cooperate and to talk, you have to do things you're not necessarily prepared to do. And when we turn to Ottawa, we are told we don't have the 400 million lying around here. Well, look. It borders on hypocrisy, doesn't it? It's totally outrageous. But on the face of it, that's what we've done with the Official Languages Act. This is something that works very, very well. The federal government has recognized and enshrined in law that French is threatened everywhere in Canada, even in Quebec, where it's in the majority. The basic premise is that Canada is there to defend people in minority situations. The paradigm shift is now that the new legislation defends languages where they're threatened. It hasn't taken anything away from Franco-Manitobans, for example. That's what I've always been saying. We're simply recognizing the fact. We're really making a statement. We've even seen you share the same podium with Ms. Petitpas-Taylor here at the Montreal Board of Trade. As a rule, Quebec and Ottawa have always been at loggerheads over language. How would you describe this achievement? I wouldn't use the word historic. Politicians use that word far too much. Other people will decide whether it's historic or not. But it was a rare occurrence. It was unprecedented. It needs to be repeated with other ministers to show that it wasn't just a mistake. This is a path we blaze together. Maybe we can do it more than once. Your relationship with Ms. Petitpas-Taylor's successor, Randy Boissonneau, what's that like? I got along very well with Mr. Boissonneau. I've only met him once. I'm not yet calling him Randy, but I hope we'll get there. I should be meeting him again soon, but our teams are working to get us talking and to deepen the relationship a bit more. Because now we have the legislation, and now we have to work on the regulations. That's very important. Then it's a question of funding. There's an action plan on official languages, and that has to be implemented properly. We don't want the action plan to run counter to the law. We have to continue to work on that. On the decline of French in Quebec, your government has focused on French spoken at home. If you take Montreal as an example, it's a very cosmopolitan city known for its diversity. To what extent does French spoken outside the home count too as well? Well, I disagree with the fact that we're focusing on this. It's a statistic that's that disturbs people. When I say I speak French, yes, I speak French at home. I speak French at work. There's French spoken online in stores. All those indicators have declined between 2001 and 2021. It's not a question of whether we like it or not. The question is really of taking a step back. There has been a drop, no matter what indicator you're talking about. Once you see that, you have to be bold. The goal is to stop the decline of French in Quebec and in Montreal in particular, to reverse the trend, really. The mandate is to halt the decline and then to reverse it. And to do that, we have to act in all sectors. Acting in one or two sectors, but even very strongly, won't work, really. You're also Minister of the Canadian Francophonie. Your wife is Acadian. Has that helped you understand the situation of Francophones in a minority setting outside Quebec? My wife has often told me about her grandmother who lived in the Shediac area. She wasn't born in New Brunswick. I don't want to say things that are untrue, but she has special attachment to Acadia. She's talked to me very often about her grandmother, and the first trip we took together was to that area. So the strong attachment, maybe it makes things more concrete to me because I have a link to Acadia and to Acadians. But I've always thought for French to be strong in Quebec, it really had to be strong in the rest of Canada and vice versa. For French to be strong in the rest of Canada, it has to be strong in Quebec as well. Pitting one against the other is a losing game. Do you think that the new Official Languages Act corresponds to the reality of Francophones outside Quebec? Do you think that's true? I don't want to speak for them. I can't talk for them. I felt that the federations and Franco-Canadian groups really liked this legislation. They'd asked for it. So my analysis is that it's a good piece of legislation. What's important is that they say it's a good piece of legislation, or at least that it improve their lot. And what's interesting, really, is to see that this new legislation can be both good for French in Quebec and good for French outside Quebec. We avoided playing Quebec off against the rest of the Francophonie. The wearing of religious symbols will be banned for government employees in positions of authority, including primary and secondary school teachers. This is a reasonable position. We're going to be firm, and we're going to move quickly on this as well. You're also Minister for Secularism. We know that Bill 21 is being challenged in the courts. We expect it to go all the way to the Supreme Court. Now, if it does, the Trudeau government has already indicated its intention to intervene in any possible challenge. We expect this case to be appealed to the Supreme Court of Canada. And if that happens, our government is determined to contribute to the debate. Given the vast implications for all Canadians across the country, and the need to defend the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, how do you see Bill 21 evolving in the future? Well, I don't think it needs to evolve. It's been passed. There's something special about this legislation. Look, we live in a democracy, and I don't think that Quebecers and Canadians expect a government made up of judges. Judges do their jobs. Police officers do their job. I don't think that judges should be undoing legislation duly passed by people who are elected by Quebecers. If Quebecers really think that the law on secularism is wrong, well, it'll become an election campaign issue, a ballot question, and a party that runs on undoing this legislation won't be elected. I don't see any other way of respecting the Quebec people and Quebec nation's will than by doing it this way. For the Canadian government to attack a law passed by Quebec, for me, that's completely unacceptable. It's intolerable, outrageous. I don't feel like collaborating on that. It makes no sense. So it seems very, very, very clear. You won't cooperate on this. No, I won't cooperate with people who are trying to undo laws passed by the National Assembly, not on this topic anyway. You know that there are members of cultural communities who consider this law discriminatory. What's your response to them? Not at all. Secularism is something that protects individual and collective freedoms. The secular nature of the state leads to state neutrality. State neutrality allows freedom of religion and freedom of conscience as well. Many people come from countries where religion and the state are one and the same. They're very happy to live in a country where they can be absolutely sure of having full freedom of conscience, and knowing that there won't be a religious police telling them what to do or what to think. I think it's an area of freedom that we've provided to ourselves. A few days ago, you were in Halifax representing Premier François Legault at the Council of the Federation. Mr. Legault said there was a scheduling conflict. How do you see your role as Minister for Relations with Canada? Well, I'm part of a team. I'm often called upon to work in cooperation with my colleagues, for example, with the Minister of Health, Christian Dubé, to negotiate federal health transfers, and with Éric Girard, because this is a financial issue, a fiscal issue. Same thing with my colleague, France-Hélène Duranceau, for housing. We've just negotiated and agreed on a $900 million contribution from the federal government. This is Quebecers' money that's been given back to us, and so we work as a team. Ministers have their own files, and they work together to explain to federal stakeholders what Quebec's position is. Very often, we want an asymmetrical agreement, a nation-to-nation agreement, so that everybody wins. And at the end of the day, I think that people are very happy with Mr. Legault, Mr. Trudeau can agree. We know we can reach agreement between Quebec and Canada. I think that's a good deal. It means I've done my job properly. As was the case last week in Montreal, when you announced a joint investment of $1.8 billion for the construction of social housing in Quebec. That's right. There were $900 million from the Quebec government, $900 million from the Canadian government, virtually unconditionally, no strings attached. Initially, the federal government's offer was to tie these transfers to a bunch of conditions that encroached on Quebec's area of jurisdiction. But in the end, we found common ground and we came up with something that suited everyone. That's my role. There's a way to get along. Of course there is. Now, your government recently announced its intention to significantly increase tuition fees for university students from outside Quebec. Do you think this initiative will have an impact on your role as Minister of Relations with Canada? Do you think that's the case? Well, probably to the extent that people will ask questions. It hasn't really happened yet. I was just at the Premier's meeting 10 days ago. None of the premiers raised this. If it was really of a big concern, they could have asked the Quebec representative to explain it. But that didn't happen. But if anyone asks the question, I'll answer them. This is the product of a lot of hard work by a working group on the French language, a group that I chair. It's a group made up of six ministers. It was set up in January 2023. We're working on immigration, culture, and of course, language. And one of the measures is the one that was put forward. I don't think we can let the current situation continue. I understand that some people might agree with the measure. Okay, what do we do? Because the status quo is untenable. As I said earlier, all the indicators are in the red, particularly in Montreal. So right now, this means that people coming to Montreal don't speak French at all.
ça amène une pression.
This puts pressure on French language training institutions. Do we really want people who don't speak French, who don't want to stay here, come to Montreal and anglicize it? We have to ask ourselves so that question. There will be a major and very negative impact for us because with the increase in tuition fees for students from the rest of Canada, it's basically tuition fees will double. I don't necessarily think it's the right decision from universities. I like a window on the world. I think they're closing the window. The English-speaking university presidents here in Montreal have obviously reacted very strongly. They seem to want to find a compromise. Do you think that a compromise is possible? Well, I'm sure we'll find a solution. There's always a solution to all issues. A compromise, I don't know how we'll call it, but we'll find a solution. But in the long run, two things have to be settled. There has to be a rebalancing of university funding. Right now, students studying in English language universities have much higher per capita funding than those studying in French language universities. If there's an imbalance that can no longer be tolerated, it doesn't make sense. And as I told you earlier, there are about 30,000 students in downtown Montreal studying in the two English language universities located in the heart of the city, and they're not Quebecers. Is this a good idea, given that we currently have a serious problem? The French language is on the decline in Montreal. I'm not saying they're not welcome, of course, but we have to wonder, how many can we reasonably absorb? How many can we provide French language training to? What are the priority issues for Quebec in the coming months in terms of its relationship with the federal government, with Ottawa, therefore? Well, that's the question. There's the negotiations for health transfers. That's not yet been settled. It's our money, after all. We're talking about $900 million to $1 billion a year. This is Quebec taxpayers' money. We have to deal with that. Then there's the issue of temporary immigrants in Quebec. We've announced that temporary immigrants will have to be proficient in French to renew their work permits after 3 years. On the other hand, there are many temporary immigrants in Quebec about whom the Quebec government has no say. They have the international mobility program permits, and for these people, there are no conditions, there's no requirement to learn French, so they could be here temporarily for 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, 8 years without any requirement to learn French. I think that's an issue, and we've been making representations to Ottawa so that French language training be required. So these are issues we'll have to keep an eye on. I want to hear from you now about your hobby as a novelist. You've just published a novel, Abordage. It was your third adult novel. The others were for children. Where do you find the time to write novels, therefore? Saturday morning sometimes, and then very, very late when I'm in Quebec City. And then we leave on Tuesday morning very early. We come back on Thursday evening very late. So I have Tuesday evening and Wednesday evening in Quebec City. I finish work pretty late. But when I get home to my apartment, my wife and my sons are not there. So instead of watching a film or series, I start writing, and that's when I find a bit of time to write. Some people have said he mustn't be working very, very hard. He's just published a novel. It took me 5 years to write it. So if you count the pages, 300 pages in 5 years, I think it really shows that I've been focusing on my work as my job as a minister. I don't doubt it. In your latest novel, you revisit the world of pirates. Why did you decide to use that as the topic of your novel? Well, it's not really about pirates. It's really about a pivotal moment in history, Quebec history, the early 18th century. My novel is set around 1720 in the Caribbean. Something exceptional is happening. All the great powers are there. France, Spain, Portugal, the Basque countries, There are even settlers from Quebec, New France, of course, extended all the way down to Louisiana at the time. There are natives, aboriginals, and all these people are in a small territory. They're forced to live together. Sometimes they do it in harmony. Other times it's a bit ugly. It's exploitation. The clash of cultures, the clash of powers is happening at the right place, at the right time, or the wrong place at the wrong time. Depends on how you look at it. But it was a pivotal moment for the destiny of North America. So if you look at my main character, that he's there. There are lots of there's lots of potential for adventure, betrayal, so love stories. Everything's possible. Now, you talked about your two grown-up children. You said they're no longer at home. They don't accompany you to Quebec City when you were at the National Assembly. I read in the papers that you talk to them every day. Do you talk to them about politics? Only when they talk to me about it. When I was first elected in 2014, they were young, 8 and 10. Every morning, I'd open my iPad. I would put it on the kitchen table. I'd open FaceTime, and we didn't necessarily talk. We just pretended I was there and they were with me, so it kept us close. I didn't sit down and talk to them. It's as if we were at home. I didn't just talk about serious things, of course. Then the evening, I talked to them every night, too. Now I talk to them almost every night, because they're 18 and 20, have their own lives. 17 and 20, they're young adults. But I'm very, very close to them as a father. Has it been hard for you to reconcile politics and family? For the first term, yes, it was, absolutely. They were young. It was new. We had to find a balance. I miss them dearly. Since you became an MP in 2014, you've organized the Jean-François Roberge run in your riding to help all kinds of causes. Tell us about the impact of this event. Well, it's interesting because as soon as I became an MNA, I became aware of the very rich ecosystem that existed. There were many community organizations that were taking care of the most disadvantaged, and they were always organizing activities, and they would invite me to participate, to contribute. That was great. At one point, I thought, well, perhaps I could do something. Perhaps I could take the initiative for the community groups or for causes I cared about. And that's when I decided to organize a race with my riding office employees. I decided to create an event to reach out to sponsors and get contributions and to do something that would be completely nonpartisan, to organize an activity that was very accessible, a 1 kilometer walk. It's easy to do that. You can run it if you want. Every year, there are new people who do it. There's a 5 kilometer race as well. So I do that every year. I'm sure there must be young people who ask you questions about politics, those who might be interested in getting involved in politics. Would you recommend politics to them? Would you? Well, I would recommend that they get involved and try to make a difference. They could get involved in municipal, federal, or provincial politics. It could be in a community organization, could be in an advocacy group. Do anything you can, but don't just stay at home with your feet up on the ottoman, criticizing those people who try to do something. You have to be part of 10% of people who do 90% of things. You have to get involved, and after that, you'll meet lots of people who are passionate and exciting. That's what's so stimulating when you're in politics. You're surrounded by people. They want to change the world. They see a problem. They want to talk about it. They want to find a solution. That's what they want to do. That's very, very stimulating. And that's what I say to my daughters and what I say to people around me. Try it. Are you thinking about your life after politics now? I'm a very much in the now guy. I'm at the beginning of my term. I'm still passionate about it. I love my ministry. I'm doing this one mandate at a time. Since 2014, I haven't thought I'll be here for 2 terms, 3 terms, 8 terms. I haven't thought about the future. I've received a mandate from the citizens of Chambly to listen to them, to advocate for them, to understand them, to represent them. That's very, very important. Before you're a minister, you're an MA. And then the Premier entrusted me with another mandate, so I have a list of things to do. That's fine. So I can't say where I'll be in the next election or in 3 years' time or in 8 years' time. I don't know what I'll do. I don't know what I'll do next. But in the meantime, you're a minister of various ministries, Jean-François Roberge. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.